Hi everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Andhra Pradesh, India. I'm also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Today we are going to talk about a very important clinical concept, the differences between the axonal neuropathy and demyelinating neuropathy. The differences between the axonal neuropathy and demyelinating neuropathy. But to understand that, first we need to know about peripheral neuropathy. What is peripheral neuropathy? What is the peripheral nervous system? The nervous system is divided into two parts. One, the central nervous system. Second, the peripheral nervous system. The central nervous system includes brain and spinal cord. The central nervous system includes brain and spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system includes the nervous system which is outside the brain, that is the cranial nerves, and outside the spinal cord, that is the peripheral nerves. So in essence, the peripheral nervous system is made up of the cranial nerves and peripheral nerves. The cranial nerves are from 3 to 12. The first and second cranial nerves are excluded because they are the continuation of the brain. They are part of the brain. So the cranial nerves 3 to 12 and the peripheral nerves form part of the peripheral nervous system. When this system gets affected, we call that as peripheral neuropathy. So the manifestations could be motor, wherein they will have weakness, or sensory, wherein they will have sensory loss, or autonomic, where they can have impairment of involuntary structures. So motor, sensory, or autonomic. Right. Now let's see about the axonal neuropathy and demyelinating neuropathy. To understand this, we need to understand the pathophysiology. The nerve is essentially made up of a central core structure, which we call it as an axon. So a nerve is made up of a central structure, the core structure, the wire, which we call it as axon. So the nerve impulses travel slowly through the axon and is responsible for the amplitude of the nerves seen in the nerve conduction studies. The second component is the covering of the axon. The covering of the axon, what we call it as the myelin sheath. So the covering of the axon is known as the myelin sheath. The myelin sheath of the central nervous system is formed by oligodendroglia, and the myelin sheath of the peripheral nervous system is formed by Schwann cells. So the myelin sheath, in between we have gaps, what we call is as nodes of Ranvier. So what is the main function of the myelin sheath? It helps to increase the speed of the nerve conduction impulse. As I said, axon, the impulse travels very slowly and is responsible for the amplitude of the nerve conduction studies. Whereas when it is well myelinated, an impulse jumps from the one node of Ranvier to the other node of Ranvier like a kangaroo. And this is known as saltatory conduction. It helps in the facilitation of the nerve impulse. The nerve impulse travels at a great speed, so the conduction velocity will be increased as long as the myelin sheath is intact. If the myelin sheath is affected, the conduction velocity gets decreased. So, two important aspects. One, axons are the central wire or core of the structure, which is responsible for the slow conduction of the nerve impulse, and it basically forms an amplitude in the nerve conduction studies. The axon is covered by the myelin sheath, wherein there are gaps which are known as nodes of Ranvier, where an impulse jumps from one node of the Ranvier to the other node of the Ranvier, what we call it as saltatory conduction, and hence the conduction velocity is very good in persons who have myelinated nerves. And another important concept is that there are myelin fibers over the axons. The outermost conducts at a very great speed, then next at a slightly lesser speed, next at a slightly lesser speed. So if all the myelin fibers are equally affected, like a hereditary neuropathy like Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, the conduction velocity will be equally impaired in all the nerves. But in acquired neuropathies like Guillain-Barré syndrome, what happens? Some fibers of the myelin sheath are affected. Some fibers of the myelin sheath are not affected. So the fiber, where the fiber is intact, the myelin sheath, it travels at a great speed. Where the myelin fiber next is slightly affected, travels at a lesser speed. Then still lesser speed. So when they are not uniformly affected, when a non-uniform affection takes place of the myelinated nerves, it gives rise to temporal dispersion. So serrated appearance, while the nerves conducting, the myelin sheath conducting, conduction velocity at a great speed will go like this. Second conduction velocity, which is at a slightly lower speed, will decrease. Third will still decrease. So there is a serrated appearance, what we call it as temporal dispersion. So very important concepts. Axonal neuropathy causes a decrease in amplitude. Demyelination causes a decrease in conduction velocity and prolongation of distal latencies because of the decrease in speed. But if it is uniformly affected, it causes a generalized decrease in conduction velocity like Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease. But if it is an acquired neuropathy like Guillain-Barré syndrome, all nerve fibers are not equally affected. So there will not be uniform decrease in the speed. There will be a non-uniform decrease in speed, giving a serrated appearance in nerve conduction studies, what we call it as temporal dispersion. Right. These are the two important pathophysiological concepts. Now let's see the clinical differences. Axonal neuropathy and demyelinating neuropathy. Very important clinical concept is that axonal neuropathy is a length-dependent neuropathy. Axonal neuropathy is a length-dependent neuropathy, whereas a demyelinative disease is a length-independent neuropathy. Axonal neuropathy is a length-dependent neuropathy. Classic example is diabetes. What is this length-dependent neuropathy? When the nerves are long, the distalmost parts gets affected, and then slowly proximal, and then with passage of time still more proximal. So from the distal to the proximal extension of the pathological process, we call this a length dependent neuropathy. So our upper limbs and the lower limb nerves are the lengthiest. So if it is an axonal type of neuropathy, a length dependent neuropathy, first the distalmost parts of the lower limb, that is the feet, gets affected. And then slowly it ascends, then till the knees it gets affected. Once it touches the knees, the hands start getting affected, the gloves, and then slowly it gets affected, the elbow joint, a graded type of sensory loss. So glove and stocking type of sensory loss is a length dependent neuropathy seen in axonal neuropathies like diabetes mellitus. What is this length dependent neuropathy? When the nerve cell gets affected, it cannot transmit the nutrients. So the distalmost parts first get affected because it has to traverse a long distance. After some time, the next distalmost part. After some time, the next most distal part. Until where it is severely affected, it comes very proximally. So a graded type of sensory loss is a length-dependent neuropathy, axonal neuropathy we see in diabetes. Whereas in a demyelinated neuropathy, it is a length-independent. Both proximal and distal parts are equally affected. Classic example is Guillain-Barré syndrome, where distal and proximal parts almost get affected at the same time. Again, reflexes. We take reflexes or motor. Everything is length dependent in axonal neuropathy. For example, classic example of axonal neuropathy is diabetes. So what happens when it is length dependent, when we take the reflexes, ankle reflex is first lost, then the knee jerk is lost. So it is a graded type of involvement, nerve involvement. So first the distalmost part, ankle reflex, gets affected, then the knee jerk gets affected. Whereas if it is a demyelinating disease like Guillain-Barré syndrome, all the parts get equally affected, a global type of involvement. It is length independent. So both knee jerk, ankle jerk, biceps, triceps, everything gets affected almost at the same time. So axonal is a length dependent, demyelinator is a length independent. Axonal classic example is diabetes, Demyelinating classic example is Guillain-Barré syndrome. The motor is also likewise distal to proximal in axonal neuropathy, whereas distal and proximal muscles almost get affected equally at the same time, like Guillain-Barré syndrome in demyelinating neuropathy. The classic example for axonal neuropathy is diabetes. The classic example for demyelinating neuropathy is Guillain-Barré syndrome. Right. Now I already gave an introduction to the nerve conduction studies, but now let me emphasize how nerve conduction studies is very important in differentiating axonal neuropathy versus demyelinating neuropathy. Why is this important? Why we go to the extending beyond clinical examination and trying to do nerve conduction studies? What are the advantages? What is the benefit? The advantages and benefit of doing nerve conduction studies and confirming whether it is axonal or demyelinating is that axonal neuropathies, the prognosis is very, very bad. Since the central core is affected, the wire is affected, the axonal neuropathy, the prognosis is very bad. Like diabetes, they don't recover much. We just give palliative treatment, supportive treatment, but there's not much improvement. But demyelinating neuropathy, the prognosis is excellent, very good, because the central core or the wire is intact, only the covering is affected. So slowly there will be remyelination. After demyelination, there is remyelination after a few days to few weeks, and then the myelin sheath starts covering the axon. So recovery is excellent, rapid recovery. Classic example is Guillain-Barré syndrome. You just need to wait for 4 weeks to tide over the crisis, and they recover well. They are almost normal. So demyelinating neuropathy prognosis is excellent. Axonal neuropathy prognosis is very bad. So that's why, from the prognostic point of view, we have to do nerve conduction studies and find out. So if it is an axonal neuropathy, the prognosis is dismal, whereas if it is demyelinating neuropathy, the prognosis is excellent. So how do we confirm whether it is an axonal neuropathy or a demyelinating neuropathy? By nerve conduction studies. So when we do nerve conduction studies in demyelinating neuropathy, everything is related to conduction because of saltatory conduction. So when the myelin sheath is good, the node of Ranvier, an impulse jumps from one node of Ranvier to the other node of Ranvier, and hence the conduction velocity and saltatory conduction is very good. So when there is a demyelination, the conduction velocity gets affected. There is prolongation of distal latencies. There is another catch here. If it is an inherited neuropathy like Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, all the nerves are equally demyelinated, and therefore the conduction velocity is decreased. The prolongation of distal latency is equal in all the nerves, that is upper limbs, lower limbs, or any lower limbs, or anywhere we do. But in acquired or a focal type of demyelinating neuropathy like carpal tunnel syndrome, focal, where the median nerve gets affected, only that particular part gets affected. So the conduction velocity will get affected only in that particular part, not entirely, only that particular part gets affected. Even if you take Guillain-Barré syndrome or any acquired neuropathy, it is a patchy involvement. So in carpal tunnel syndrome, the median nerve is compressed by the carpal bones. So a focal demyelination. So there is a decrease in conduction velocity and prolongation of the distal latency at that particular point. But if it is very severe, starts compressing, more and more pressure starts coming, not only the myelin sheath, now it may go and compress even the axon. So when the axon also gets compressed secondary to the compression by the carpal bones, not only the myelin sheath is affected, but at a later point of time when the pressure is very severe, even the axons get affected. So amplitudes are also lost. So generally demyelination, only the conduction velocity is slowed, but if it is a focal neuropathy like carpal tunnel syndrome, there could be conduction blocks. The pressure may be so severe that not only myelin sheath, even the axons are getting affected, and therefore the amplitude may be diminished. This is one exception to the general rule that the demyelination usually affects only the conduction velocity. Right, as I said, it is a generalized in inherited neuropathy, whereas acquired it is patchy or focal. If it is carpal tunnel syndrome, it may be so severe as not only to affect the conduction velocity, but also to decrease the amplitude, because axons also get compressed by the carpal bones. The prognosis, if it is acquired like Guillain-Barré syndrome, the prognosis is very good. Right. When it comes to the axonal, as I said, the central part of the nerve is affected. The wire, the core itself is affected. So amplitudes are affected. So in axonal neuropathy, amplitudes are affected. And second, it is length dependent, graded type of sensory loss. The sensations may get affected in the foot. Slowly it starts ascending. And one more important point, important concept itself, when the sensory loss effect comes from the foot to the level of the knee, once it touches the knee, the upper limb should get affected. Glove and stocking type of sensory loss according to the length. So if a person says there's a graded sensory loss from the foot to the knee, even above the knee to the thighs and the groin, but upper limbs are intact, it is pseudo. Because once it starts coming to the knee, the upper limb should get affected. So it's a length dependent neuropathy. And axonal neuropathy, the prognosis is bad, dismal. Example, diabetes. So by nerve conduction studies, we can differentiate whether it's a demyelinating neuropathy or axonal neuropathy. Axonal neuropathy, the amplitudes are decreased. Demyelinating neuropathy, the conduction velocity is decreased. Axonal neuropathy is length dependent. Distal parts get affected, then slowly starts getting proximal. Example, diabetes. First the foot, then the knee, then the hands. Whereas demyelinating neuropathy, acquired type, is not length dependent, length independent. Globally, all parts get affected. And axonal neuropathy, the prognosis is bad. Demyelinating neuropathy, example, Guillain-Barré syndrome, they do very well. You tide over the crisis, they do very well, they recover well. So very important clinical point, because neuropathy is so common in our clinical practice, and especially with diabetes, explosion of diabetes, the neuropathies also have increased, because one of the most important cause of neuropathy is diabetes. The rule of three, the one third of the cause of neuropathy is because of diabetes, one third of the cause of neuropathy is because of other causes, one third we do not know the cause, it is idiopathic type of neuropathy. So if you have a very good understanding of the neuropathy, and if you are able to do nerve conduction studies and prognosticate, we'll be better informed. I hope you have enjoyed this lecture. If you have any suggestions or comments, kindly post on to my YouTube channel. But please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my webpage, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.